Hello everyone, let's discuss water flooding in this particular session. I will be discussing types of recovery, recovery factor and the factors affecting it, factors affecting the water flood performance, deciding time for water flood, injection well location, fractional flow theory, frontal advancement theory and water flood performance surveillance. Coming to the introduction part, which is types of recovery, I can have three recovery, which is primary, secondary and tertiary. In my primary recovery, I can have a natural flow and an artificial lift. In my secondary recovery, I can go for a water flooding process or any sort of a pressure maintenance. Coming to tertiary recovery generally constitutes of EOR methods, where I can have a thermal EOR, gas injection EOR, chemical EOR or other type of EOR. When I am talking about thermal EOR, I can have a steam, hot water or a combustion process. When it comes to gas injection, I will generally have a miscible gas injection, and the gas that I can be using while miscible gas injection are CO2, hydrocarbon or nitrogen or flue gases. Coming to the chemical EOR, I can have an alkali EOR, surfactant or a polymer, or a combination of alkali, surfactant and polymer, which is also termed as ASP flooding. Now coming to other type of EOR, I can go for a microbial EOR, an acoustic EOR or an electromagnetic EOR. And nowadays there is also another EOR, which is low saline water flooding. Coming to this IOR part, again IOR is a combination of my secondary as well as my tertiary recovery. I will discuss the difference between IOR and EOR in coming up slide. Alright, okay. Now let's look at the oil recovery. Okay, generally when I'm talking about primary recovery, at that time my recovery will be less than 30%. For a secondary recovery, this should be between 30 to 50%, and for a tertiary recovery it is greater than 50% and sometimes up to 80%. And by the way, the values that is the recovery factor values that I am discussing over here, that is 30, 30 to 50 and greater than 50%, this is very high values. Okay, generally in the field these kind of recoveries are not obtained, because as we all know, my reservoir is a very heterogeneous system and it becomes a very tedious task to understand the reservoir. Okay, so these kind of recoveries are generally not obtained, but theoretically when someone is asking, then we can say that up to 30% I am getting primary, 30 to 50% I can obtain a secondary recovery, and greater than 50% I can obtain if I am going for a tertiary recovery. Alright, okay. Now let's look at the theory part. Coming to primary production is the first oil out. That means the easy oil, that whatever is present in the reservoir, so that comes under primary production. In my primary recovery process, the natural pressures at the depth will cause the oil to flow through the rock or sand formation toward the lower pressure wellbore, where it is lifted to the surface. Okay, that means natural processes, the natural reservoir energy that it has already, okay, that will help us in obtaining the oil to the surface. Oil ceases to flow, at that time we can go for an artificial lift method. Okay, again in artificial lift method, we know that by using an artificial lift method, I am creating a low sand phase pressure or a low flowing bottom hole pressure. Because of this low flowing bottom hole pressure, I am creating a higher drawdown, and because of the drawdown, I am getting more amount of oil. Okay, so this natural flow and the artificial lift both are included in my primary process of recovery. Now let's talk about the secondary recovery. Now secondary recovery methods are used when there is insufficient underground pressure to move the remaining oil. Okay, when my reservoir pressure has gone down and there is not enough amount of reservoir pressure that it can move my remaining oil, at that time I should go for secondary recovery processes. By the secondary recovery processes, basically what we are trying to do is that we are trying to create or we are trying to maintain the reservoir pressure. Okay, now the most common technique being water flooding. As the water flows through the formation toward the producing well, it sweeps some of the oil it encounters along with it. Okay, talking about my EOR or at the enhanced oil recovery, it refers to the recovery of the oil that is left behind after my primary and secondary recovery processes, which are either exhausted or no longer economical. Once I undergone my primary process of recovery and after my secondary recovery process, okay, now if I want to produce more amount of oil, then I should resort for an enhanced oil recovery. Now a very important note point over here is that my conventional recovery targets mobile oil in the reservoir and the EOR targets immobile oil. That is the oil which cannot be produced during due to high capillarity and IFT. I will discuss what is capillarity and IFT in coming up slide. Now let's look at the hydrocarbon recovery. Now you can see that this particular graph is for field flow rate versus time. So initially I have gone for a primary production only. See, initially I have gone for a primary recovery process. At that time I can see that my field has begin to decline. See, I can definitely see a decline over here. Okay, now to arrest this particular decline, okay, what I did is that now I went for a secondary recovery process. Okay, maybe I would have gone for a water flooding project. So you can see that because of going for a secondary recovery process, I was able to arrest my decline rate to some extent. See, to some extent I was able to arrest my decline rate. Okay, all right. Now after some time, what I decided to go for is that I went for a tertiary process. That means I went for a EOR process. See, and after going for a EOR process, you can see that I was able to produce more amount of oil rate. Now, if I want to account for what will be my additional recovery because of my secondary process, then this shaded region will be my additional recovery obtained because of my secondary process. Okay, and now if I want to get what would be my additional recovery because of my tertiary project, so this much amount of area what I'm shading is my additional recovery that I obtained from my tertiary process. All right. Okay. And why did I went for a secondary recovery process? That means at this particular point, my reservoir pressure would have gone down. Okay, my reservoir pressure would have fallen. Okay, now what I decided is that I want to maintain my reservoir pressure. Okay, for that, what I did is that I went for a, at this point of time, at this time, I went for a secondary recovery project. Okay, maybe a water flooding. All right, now after some time of after going for water flooding and after conducting water flooding for some amount of time, at this point I've gone for a tertiary recovery process. Okay, and why did I go for a tertiary recovery process? Maybe because high capillarity would have been developed at this time. Okay, or let's say high IFT. Because of high IFT and high capillarity, I am getting an high amount of immobile oil. Okay, now to produce this immobile oil present, now I decided to go for a tertiary recovery process in the form of an EOR. Okay, now what does this EOR does is that now it will target this immobile oil. Okay, that means whatever oil is left behind after my secondary, primary and secondary process, EOR will try to target those amount of immobile oil. All right. Okay, now let's discuss this particular graph, which is my graph of EOR, or that is graph of overall recovery versus time. Okay, now you can see that, see, till this point period, time period, this time T1, I have gone for a primary recovery. See, okay, that means if I would have gone for a primary recovery for further amount of time, I would have got this particular trend. But at this point of time, I gone for a, that is at time T1, I have went for a secondary recovery. Okay, now I did my secondary recovery for this much amount of time. Now at this point of time, I went for a, at time T2, I went for a tertiary recovery. So you can see that at this point of time, I have tertiary recovery, maybe in the form of EOR. Okay, so you can see that, let's say I would have not gone for a secondary recovery, and I would have, let's say, assume that I would have gone for a, continued with the primary recovery. Okay, that means at time T2, I would have only obtained this much amount of oil recovery factor. Okay, but since I went for a, at proper timing, I went for a secondary recovery, you can see that I have got an additional recovery at time T2. I have got this much amount of additional recovery factor. Okay, now let's say I would have not gone for a secondary recovery, or neither I have gone for a tertiary recovery. Okay, that means I have only continued with the primary recovery. Now in this case, my recovery would have been, that means instead of going for a secondary or a tertiary recovery, I am continuing with my primary recovery. Okay, so this would have been my recovery factor. Okay, now at time T3, this would have been my recovery factor. Now, in this particular project, since I have gone for a tertiary recovery, the recovery factor I am obtaining is this much. That means this much amount of additional recovery factor I am obtaining because of proper timing. That means at proper time I went for a secondary project, secondary recovery project, and at a proper timing I went for a tertiary recovery project. Alright, so the thing that I want to discuss over here is that the timing is very important. The timing is very important for my secondary and tertiary recovery project. Okay, so this timing, so generally it is done in my field development. Okay, whatever field development, whenever I'm going for a field development, at that time a multidisciplinary team of reservoir engineers, production engineer, drilling engineers, जियोफिजिसिस्ट, जियोलॉजिस्ट, केमिस्ट, फिजिशियंस, ओके, ऑल द काइंड ऑफ पीपल कम टूगेदर एंड फॉर्म अ मल्टी डिसिप्लिनरी टीम, ओके, एंड दे डिसाइड विच ईओआर प्रोजेक्ट एंड एट वॉट टाइम शुड बी इम्प्लीमेंटेड, ओके, सो दैट वी गेट द मैक्सिमम रिकवरी फ्रॉम द फील्ड, ओके, एट द एंड ऑफ द डे वी वॉन्ट मैक्सिमम रिकवरी फ्रॉम द फील्ड, दैट मीन्स वी वॉन्ट वी वॉन्ट टू एक्सप्लॉयट एज मच अमाउंट ऑफ ऑयल एज पॉसिबल. नाउ इन फील्ड डेवलपमेंट वॉट आई डू इज दैट, लेट्स से आई हैव डिसाइडेड आई वॉन्ट टू गो फॉर अ ईओआर प्रोसेस, ओके, लेट्स से आई वॉन्ट टू गो फॉर अ केमिकल ईओआर, ओके. नाउ फॉर दैट वेरी फर्स्ट थिंग दैट विल बी डन इज बाय इज टू क्रिएट अ रिजर्वर मॉडल, ओके, दैट मीन्स दे क्रिएट अ रिजर्वर मॉडल ऑन द कंप्यूटर्स एंड दे रन रिजर्वर सिमुलेशन ऑन इट, ओके. Now on running my reservoir simulation, I will get some result, okay. If I am getting some sort of a satisfactory result, okay, then only then the project will move ahead to a pilot scale project, okay. Pilot scale project means that at a very small scale in the field the project has been implemented, okay. Now once the pilot scale project is also successful in nature, okay, then and then only a full scale implementation of project is done. The amount of cost is has to be invested before going for a full scale implementation. So that's why success of a pilot scale and success of a reservoir simulation becomes very necessary before going for any sort of a secondary or a tertiary recovery project. Discuss this particular point. After water flooding process, my secondary recovery process, that is after my water flooding process, that means after my secondary recovery process, oil will remain trapped in the pores because of high capillarity pressure. Okay. Now in this particular figure, you can see that you can see that my at discovery, okay, this particular figure is for at discovery, my sand grain is coated with water and the pores are filled with my oils, okay. Now this second figure shows us that I have gone for a water flooding project. So you can see that as my water is sweeping through the reservoir, you can see that my oil is being swept out. At the end of water flood, you can see that there are oil globules which are trapped in the pores. There are oil droplets which are trapped in the pores. Okay. Now these oil droplets which are trapped in the pores, the reason may be high capillarity and high IFT. Now we need to recover these oil droplets also. Okay. So now to recover this, EOR has to be done. Alright. So this is where EOR comes into action. Coming to EOR versus IOR, my IOR means method supplementing reservoir forces and energy. And EOR refers to the recovery of the oil that is left behind after my primary and secondary recovery methods. Now, coming to IOR, IOR can be a secondary recovery process, that means it can be a water flooding or gas flooding, mainly pressure maintenance and sweep. IOR can be a EOR project, okay, that means EOR project means my reduction of the IFT between the displacing fluid and oil, my increasing the capillary number, by reducing the capillary forces, increasing the dry water viscosity, provide mobility control, oil swelling, oil viscosity reduction, alteration of the reservoir rock wettability, okay. This thing I will discuss in detail when I discuss EOR. My IOR can also constitute of my production enhancement technique like optimizing the artificial lift, a well stimulation, changing completion strategy or a workover, okay. IOR will also constitute my infill well drilling or a step out wells, okay. Again, infill wells, this kind of a wells are drilled to increase my EOR, estimated ultimate recovery. EOR I have already discussed in my decline curve session. So these are the four things that are constituted in IOR. Okay, now let's move further. Now let's discuss water injection versus water flooding. Now coming to water injection, the process of injecting water into the aquifer is termed as water injection. Okay, so you can see that in this particular figure of cross section, you can see that I have injector wells, okay, and these injector wells are injecting water into the aquifer part. In the map view also, you can see that I have my water injection wells in the aquifer part, okay. These red dots are represented by oil producers, okay. Now you can see that my water is being injected in the aquifer. All right, the main purpose of going for a water injection is maintaining the reservoir pressure, and second is wastewater disposal. Again, maintaining reservoir pressure, as we all know, as I'm producing my reservoir fluids from the reservoir, my reservoir pressure will decline. Okay, now to reduce this decline or to stop this decline of reservoir pressure, I will try to inject my water, okay, so that whatever volume I am producing, आई एम कॉम्पनसेटिंग इट बाई इंजेक्टिंग वाटर बैक इन टू द रिजर्वर. ओके बाई डूइंग दैट आई एम एबल टू मेंटेन माई रिजर्वर प्रेशर. नाउ कमिंग टू सेकेंड पॉइंट विच इज द वेस्ट वाटर डिस्पोजल. इन माई ऑनशोर दिस वेस्ट वाटर डिस्पोजल बिकम्स अ चैलेंज फॉर अस. ओके बिकॉज इट हैज टू फॉलो द सर्टन सेफ्टी नॉर्म्स. ओके दैट मीन्स वी कैन नॉट डायरेक्टली डिस्पोज द वॉटर इन टू द रिवर्स और लेक्स. ओके सो दैट्स वाई इन द ऑनशोर जनरली वॉट एवर प्रोड्यूस्ड वॉटर वी आर हैविंग. ओके दैट मीन्स एज वी नो एट द सर्फेस फ्रॉम द रिजर्वर आई विल गेट ऑयल गैस एंड वॉटर. ओके सो वॉट एवर दिस प्रोड्यूस्ड वॉटर आई एम गेटिंग एट द सर्फेस इन ऑनशोर वॉट आई डू इज दैट आई ट्रीट इट एंड आई ट्राई टू इंजेक्ट इट बैक टू द रिजर्वर. So that's one thing. In the offshore, generally, whatever produced water I am getting, okay, after going for a basic treatment process, I can inject it back into the sea. Okay, I can throw the water back to the sea. Okay, so that's how water disposal in offshore works. Now, coming to water flood. Now, water flood over here is that process of injecting water into the oil reservoir. Okay, take special note. I am now injecting my water into the oil reservoir. In water injection, what I was doing is that I was injecting the water into the aquifer. But in water flooding, what I am doing here is that I am directly injecting my water into the reservoir. Okay, in the figure also you can see it very clearly that I have injector wells. Okay, I have injector wells, so you can see that I am injecting my water into the oil reservoir. Okay, now because of this injection, you can see that this is the 3D view and this is my cross-sectional view. See, I have injector well, I have a producer well. I am injecting my water into my oil reservoir. Okay, as a result, this water is trying to sweep the oil towards the producer well. All right, okay. Now, let's look at the purpose of water flooding is also to maintain reservoir pressure, obviously similar to the water injection. And second is to increase the volumetric sweep efficiency. I will discuss what is volumetric sweep efficiency in coming up slide. Okay, so that's the primary purpose over here. So take special note that there is a clear distinction between what is water injection and what is water flooding. Okay, so don't get confused between both. Coming to recovery factor. Recovery factor is a product of my displacement efficiency, my aerial efficiency and my vertical sweep efficiency. Okay. To basic oil recovery equation. Now this NP means my produced volume. Okay, my produced volume will be equal to my EV, which is my volumetric sweep efficiency, into ED. ED is my displacement sweep efficiency into VP. VP is my pore volume. Okay, into my SOI. SOI is my oil saturation divided by BO. EV is my volumetric sweep efficiency. Volumetric sweep efficiency will be equal to the product of aerial into vertical. NP is my cumulative oil recovery. EA is my aerial sweep efficiency. EI is my vertical sweep efficiency. ED is my displacement or local sweep efficiency. SOI is my initial oil saturation and VP is my pore volume. Coming to displacement sweep efficiency. Displacement sweep efficiency is also termed as my microscopic efficiency. Okay, microscopic displacement sweep efficiency. Now ED is the ratio of my pore volume of the oil mobilized by the EOR agent divided by the pore volume of the oil contacted by the EOR agent. Okay, the formula for finding out ED is SOI minus SOR divided by SOI, where SOI is my initial oil minus my SOR, which is my residual oil, divided by initial oil. Okay, so that will give me my ED. Now ED depends on size of pores and heterogeneity. I will discuss ED or displacement efficiency in coming up slide. Okay. Now coming to volumetric sweep efficiency. Now this volumetric sweep efficiency gives us the macroscopic displacement. When we were talking about displacement efficiency, I was talking about microscopic. Over here it is macroscopic. Macroscopic means the big scale displacement. Okay. Now EV is my reservoir volume of the oil contacted by the displacement agent divided by my reservoir volume of oil originally in place. Now EV or the volumetric sweep efficiency is the product of EA or the aerial sweep efficiency into my vertical sweep efficiency. All right, now coming to aerial sweep efficiency, EA is equal to my ratio of area contacted by the displacement agent divided by the total area. Now it depends on the mobility ratio, pattern and the aerial heterogeneity. Coming to vertical sweep efficiency, which is EVI. EVI is equal to length contacted by the displacing agent divided by my total length. It depends on the degree of gravity segregation, mobility ratio and vertical heterogeneity. I will discuss these things in coming up slide. particular figure shows us the volumetric sweep efficiency. Okay, over here. Now this white region over here shows the swept regions, and this dark region shows my unswept regions. Okay, that means this swept region shows us how much amount of oil is being contacted by my displacing agent. Okay, so my volumetric sweep efficiency will be equal to this swept region divided by the volume of this cuboid. Okay, this cuboidal reservoir, whatever volume is there, I will divide my swept region divided by the cuboidal volume. That will give me my volumetric sweep efficiency. Now, to find out what would be my vertical sweep efficiency, what I will do is that I will divide this swept region, that is this white region, divided by the length, or divided by this entire length of the reservoir. Okay, now coming to this aerial sweep efficiency. Now, to find out what will be the aerial sweep efficiency, I will divide this swept region, which is shown by the white portion, divided by the actual area, by this area of the reservoir. Again, my volumetric sweep efficiency is the product of my aerial sweep efficiency into my vertical sweep efficiency, and my total recovery factor will be equal to the product of displacement, product of aerial and vertical sweep efficiency. Okay, alright, now let's move further. Anyways, I am going to discuss this in detail in coming up slide. Now the recovery factor. Now let's discuss the improvement of displacement efficiency. How do you improve my displacement efficiency? To improve this, I will decrease my SOR, miscible or near miscible gas injection, I will go for it. I will go for a chemical flood surfactant. I will take advantage of gravity forces. I will go for oil vaporization. Okay, these things are involved in EOR processes. Okay, so when I discuss EOR processes, at that time I will discuss what are the techniques to improve this displacement efficiency. Alright, now how to improve the volumetric sweep efficiency? To improve my volumetric sweep efficiency, I will go for lowering of mobility ratio by increasing the viscosity of displacing agent. Okay, now mobility ratio over here is the ratio of my displacing phase, it is the ratio of my displacing to displaced, where displacing is my water and displaced phase is my oil. Now lambda, which is the mobility of water equal to KRW, or relative permeability of water to my water viscosity, divided by KRO, oil relative permeability upon my oil viscosity. Okay, now if I'm doing this, I will get this equation. Now this is a very important table over here. When my m equal to 1, at that time I can term it as to be a neutral. At that time my water and oil move equally in my reservoir. When my m, or when my mobility is less than 1, at that time I can be termed it as a favorable condition, and my oil will move easier than the water. So you can see that when I am having low m, okay, at that time you can see that, see, this is my injector well, this is my producer well. Now when I am having low mobility ratio, at that time I am getting a favorable condition. That means, see, the water injection, I am, whatever water injection I am going doing, it is clearly sweeping whatever oil is present. See the sweep. It is properly sweeping the entire reservoir, right? Okay, proper contact is there. Now when I'm having m greater than 1, that is my unfavorable condition. Over here, this particular figure shows us my high mobility ratio thing. Okay, now you can see that my water will move easier than the oil. So over here you can see that my water is trying to finger out, there is high amount of fingering in my reservoir. So you can see that there are many portion of oil which is been unswept. Okay, so unswept region will be very much high when I am having high mobility ratio. Okay, so I will always try to maintain a low mobility ratio whenever I am going for a water flooding project. Now to maintain low mobility ratio, you can see that, as we know, this is the formula for m. Now to maintain low mobility ratio, I should have a high water viscosity. If I am having high water viscosity, I can have a low mobility ratio. All right, or I can go for a low oil viscosity. When I am having low oil viscosity also, at that time also I can get low mobility ratio. Okay, so when can I increase my water viscosity? This particular thing is possible when I am having a polymer flooding. Okay, when I am going for a water flooding project, if I am adding polymer to my water flood, at that time I will get a high water viscosity. Okay, now when can I get a low oil viscosity? This particular case is applicable when I am having a thermal EOR. Because of this thermal EOR, I am able to reduce the viscosity of oil present in the reservoir. Okay, and now because of this oil viscosity reduction, I can get a lower mobility ratio. Okay, all right. Now let's move further. Coming to the principle of water flooding. Now again, this particular figure I have discussed before. At the discovery, I will have this kind of a sand. I will have this kind of a system where my sand grains are coated with my water, and the pores between the sand grains are filled with oil. Okay. Now, as I am going for a water flooding project, you can see that I am sweeping the oil. Okay, I am sweeping the oil towards my producer well. Now, at the end of water flood project, see what I am left out with oil droplets which are trapped in the pores. Okay, now these oil droplets are my immobile oil. Now, to produce this immobile oil, I will go for a UR project. Now, coming to, let's look at this particular figure. This particular figure over here indicates oil rate versus my time elapsed. So you can see that for primary production, you can see this would be my trend. This would have been my trend. Now, at this particular point of the project cycle, I have gone for my start of water injection. Okay, so let this be my T1. And after some time, after some amount of delta T, after some time only, I am getting the response in my production. Okay, because over here the reservoir fill up has to be taken. That means whatever water I am injecting, okay, initially there was some amount of void created because of reservoir fluids being produced. Okay, now at the initial stage of my water flooding, that means after few years or after few time of water flooding, only my reservoir will get filled up with the water being injected. Okay, now once it gets filled up properly, then only I will get the production response. So you can see that after some time of T1 only, I am getting a production response. Okay, so when I'm starting to get my production response, I can see a definite increase in my oil rate. Okay, so this is the oil rate being produced, and whatever region is occupied by this blue region shows us the additional recovery that I am obtaining. Let's look at the theory part. My injected water will try to sweep the oil towards the producer well. We have already seen that. Now this increases the volumetric sweep efficiency, thus increasing the recovery of oil. Again, volumetric sweep efficiency is the product of my aerial sweep efficiency into my vertical sweep efficiency. At the end of water flood, the oil droplets will remain trapped in the pores, which can be removed by UR only. Alright, okay. Now let's look at this particular cross section where I am going for a water injection project. I have some water injector over here, and I have some water oil producer over here. Okay. Now, as I am injecting my water, there will be some amount of bypassed oil. Okay, why this oil remains bypassed? Because of high capillarity and high IFT. Okay, because of this high capillarity and high IFT, I will have some immobile oil present. Okay, that means I will have some bypassed oil. Alright, now. So you can see that this water is trying to sweep the oil towards my producer well. Alright, now if I am looking, so this is a macroscopic view. This particular figure shows us the macroscopic detail. Now let's look at the microscopic view. This is my microscopic view. See, if I am trying to magnify this particular region, I will get this kind of a system. Okay. Now over here, this is my sand grain, and this is the water being. See, the blue region shows us the water that has already traveled through my sand grains. And I am also able to see this immobile oil also. That means this immobile oil I am not able to produce. Now to produce this immobile oil or this residual oil, I have to go for a UR process. Alright, okay, now let's move further. So again, this particular figure shows us what would be the efficiency look like. This is the microscopic displacement efficiency. So you can see that my water has already traveled through the sand grain, and whatever oil is left behind, these are my residual oil. This particular figure shows us my aerial sweep efficiency. You can see that this is my injector well and this is my producer well. Okay, so my injector well has traveled through this, and I was not able to produce these volumes. Okay, so these are my bypassed oil, and this blue region shows us my water swept zone. Now coming to vertical sweep efficiency, this particular figure shows us the vertical sweep efficiency. Over here you can see that my waterfront over here, see my waterfront is going. Okay, so over here I can see that in this particular region my waterfront has already reached my producer well. That means this is a high permeability streak. When I have a high permeability streak, okay, at that time my water will try to follow that high permeability streak. एंड इट विल ब्रेक थ्रू माई प्रोड्यूसर वेल एट इनिशियल टाइम. सी ओवर इन दिस रीजन माई वॉटर फ्लड हैज नॉट नॉट इट इट इज वेरी मच फार अवे फ्रॉम द प्रोड्यूसर वेल. दैट मीन्स दिस पर्टिकुलर लेयर विल हैव माई लो परमेबिलिटी. लेट्स लुक एट दिस थियरी. My EOR can be applied at any stage depending upon the reservoir characteristic and recovery. Again, it's a very important thing to be discussed over here is that my EOR, I can go for EOR at any stage. Even in my primary process, that means even in the initial stage of my reservoir life cycle also, I can go for a EOR process. It's not a compulsion that I should go for a EOR process only after my primary and secondary recovery. Okay, I can go for a EOR process at the very initial stage also. Okay, it depends on the company. Also, it depends on the field development, how they have developed, how they have planned for field development. Alright? Okay. So, if the primary recovery is low due to adverse mobility ratio or viscosity, or the viscosity is very high, then EOR is the last resort. Okay, that means if I'm not getting high amount of primary recovery, that means my primary recovery is low due to the adverse mobility ratio or my viscosity of the oil is very high, then I should go for a EOR at the initial stage only. Alright, now the main aim of EOR is to overcome the capillary forces and reduce the residual oil saturation. So this is the main aim of EOR process. Again, when we will discuss my EOR at that time, I will discuss these things again. Okay, so as of now, let's move further. Let's discuss aerial sweep efficiency. The definition of aerial sweep efficiency is the ratio of swept area to the total area lying between the injection well and the producer well. Okay, that means you can see in the figure also the swept area, the ratio of the swept area divided by the total area that is been occupied. Now, the factors influencing the aerial sweep, very first is my mobility ratio. That means with unfavorable mobility ratio, fingering occurs, and at breakthrough time, unswept area is quite high. The smaller the mobility ratio, the higher the sweep efficiency at a given time or a given fraction of water in the producing effluent. So you can see that in this figure also, you can see that when I'm having a low mobility ratio, at that time my overall aerial sweep efficiency is very high. So you can see that a proper sweep is obtained. When I'm having high mobility ratio, at that time you can see that there is this fingering. Okay, there will be this phenomenon of fingering, and because of this fingering process, I will have high amount of unswept zones. That means I will have high amount of bypassed oil. Again, M equal to 1 is my neutral case where my oil and water will move equally. M less than 1 is my favorable case where my oil will move easier than water. When M is greater than 1, it is an unfavorable case and water will move easier than the oil. Now, let's look at the second part, which is pattern. The pattern does not influence in a drastic way the aerial sweep efficiency. Okay, pattern does influence, but not in a drastic way. All right okay, now coming to heterogeneity, aerial heterogeneity. Again, aerial heterogeneity will also play a major part. When I'm having high amount of heterogeneity, that at that time let's say I have a discontinuity in the sand. Okay, so this discontinuity can also lead to a reduction in the aerial sweep efficiency. All right let's say if I'm having a high permeability streak, okay, then what happens is that my water will try to flow through this high permeability streak only. Okay, instead of sweeping the entire reservoir, if I'm having some sort of high permeability streak, my water will enter that high permeability zone and will flow through that zone only, which can lead to my reduction in aerial sweep efficiency and which can lead to high amount of bypassed oil present back in the reservoir. Let's discuss vertical sweep efficiency. Vertical sweep efficiency, as per the definition, is my vertical sweep efficiency is the ratio of swept area to the total vertical area in all the layers. It is the ratio of my swept length. Okay, it is my ratio of my swept length to the total vertical length in the layers. All right now, as a consequence of the non-uniform permeabilities in the vertical dimension, any injected fluid will move as an irregular front. Water will travel more rapidly in the more permeable layers of the reservoir. So you can see that I have a layered reservoir over here, okay, with layer 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, and each and every layer has different permeability. So you can see that in my layer 1, because it is having high permeability, my water flood has reached farther point, okay, as compared to that of other layers. you can also see that my layer 2, in my layer 2 my water has not reached further point. That means my layer 2 is having my least permeability and layer 1 will have the highest permeability. So in this particular figure, if I want to arrange my permeability ranges, then my K1 would be greater than K3, it would be greater than my K4, it would be greater than my K2. Okay, so this would be my permeability trends in this particular layered reservoir. Now coming to the factors influencing my vertical sweep efficiency, first it will be my mobility ratio. More favorable the mobility ratio, that means M less than 1, less water will be injected for the same oil production and the lesser the water injectivity index will be. Okay, that means basically what they are trying to say is that if I am having mobility ratio less than 1, I will be having high amount of recovery factor. Okay, that means I will have to inject less amount of water if I am having a favorable mobility ratio. Now coming to second point, which is the gravity forces or the gravity segregation. The fact that the water is denser than the oil leads to preferential water flow in the bottom of the layer. Thus the gravity influences my vertical sweep efficiency. However, high viscous forces, that is high injection rate, diminish this influence. Okay, now the natural tendency of the water is to be at the bottom because of the gravity. Okay, now to mitigate this particular tendency, if I am injecting my water at higher rates, then I can diminish this particular influence of this gravity. Okay, so this kind of a solution can be taken into play. That means to avoid the gravity segregation, I should inject my water at high rates. Coming to third point, which is my vertical heterogeneity. I have already discussed this vertical heterogeneity in this particular figure only. You can see that because of this vertical heterogeneity, that means because of this layering of the reservoir, my water will try to move through the least resistance path, or it will try to move through the high permeability streak. Got it? Okay, now let's move further. Coming to the displacement efficiency, the fraction of oil which gets displaced by the water when it comes in contact with the oil in the pore channels. So this is my displacement efficiency. Now coming to the factors influencing the displacement efficiency, it will be viscosities. That means the less the oil viscosity or the more the water, the less fingering will exist. Second point is densities. Their respective values will influence gravity tonguing of the heavier fluid with respect to the lighter oil. Okay, coming to IFT or the interfacial tension, it is responsible of the fact that the oil is trapped after the oil water flood. Coming to wettability, the fact that most of the reservoir rocks are water wet is advantage for water injection, since water drops will invade first the smaller space, thus decreasing its relative permeability. Third point is rate of displacement. The higher the water velocity in the reservoir, and the better is the displacement efficiency. Capillary number, obviously the smaller the repulsion in between the oil and water, or rather water with additives in it, the higher the attraction and lower the residual oil saturation. I will discuss these points in coming up slide. Now you can see that in this particular figure, this is a very good figure. When I am having high IFT, that means my oil is trapped by the pore throat restriction. See, in this particular figure, you can see that I have two sand grains, and between the sand grains, I have a oil globule present. Okay, this is my oil globule. Okay, because of high interfacial tension, my oil globule is not able to flow past through it. Now, if by some method I am reducing this IFT, then this oil will pass through this pore restriction. See, now when I am having low IFT, at that time my oil will change the shape and will now be able to pass through the sand grains. When I am having high IFT, that means my oil will not flow through the sand grains. When I am having low IFT, it will change itself, that means the shape will change and will now move through the sand grains. Now let's look at the case when I am having a high capillary forces. So this particular figure over here shows us for high capillary forces. For water wet rock, residual oil is trapped in the pore if the capillary forces are greater than the force of driving fluid. So let this be the water, okay, and this is my driving fluid. Now these are the sand grains and my oil blob is trapped inside my sand grain. Okay, so for the displacement of oil blob, okay, if I want to displace this oil blob which is at a capillary pressure of P2, then my displacing pressure, that means my displacing pressure should be greater than P2 so that my oil blob will be able to move. To the wettability system, so you can see that when I am having a water wet system, at that time my water is सी माई वॉटर इज नाउ अट्रैक्टेड और अटैच टू दी सैंड ग्रेन एंड दी पोर स्पेसिस आर ऑक्यूपाइड बाई माई ऑयल. ओके सो वेन आई एम गोइंग फॉर वॉटर इंजेक्शन एट दैट टाइम सी माई ओवरऑल रिकवरी विल बी हायर इन माई वॉटर बेड केस. बट वेन आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट अ ऑयल बेड सिस्टम एंड ऑयल बेड आई एम गोइंग फॉर अ वॉटर फेड प्रोजेक्ट यू कैन सी दैट माई ऑयल इज अट्रैक्टेड टूवर्ड्स द सैंड ग्रेन. ओके एट दैट टाइम इफ आई एम गोइंग फॉर अ वॉटर फेड प्रोजेक्ट यू कैन सी दैट माई एफिशियंसी विल बी लेस. हियर द रीजन वाई माई वॉटर बेड इज हैविंग माई हाई रिकवरी फैक्टर इज obtained when I'm going for a water flood project in a waterbed rock. The reason is my water drops will invade the smaller pores. Okay, the water will try to invade first the smaller pores, thus it reduces the relative permeability of water. Okay, so that's why I will get a higher recovery factor when I'm going for a water flooding in waterbed rocks as compared to that of a oil bed rock. Now let's move further. Capillary number is the ratio of viscous forces to the capillary forces, where it will be mu v upon sigma, where mu is the viscosity of the displacing fluid, v is the velocity of the displacing fluid, and sigma is the interfacial tension. Okay, we need to note, a very important note is that higher the capillary number, less would be the residual oil saturation in the oil reservoir. Now you can see that over here this particular graph shows us the capillary numbers versus the residual oil saturation. So you can see that when I'm having high amount of capillary number, okay, the corresponding residual oil saturation will be low. See, you can see that when I'm having low capillary number, my residual oil saturation will be high. So I will always try to implement those methods which will create high capillary number. Okay, now reduction in my residual oil saturation requires ultra low IFT by surfactants, miscible gas injection and or very high pressure gradient by viscous polymer to overcome the strong capillary pressure. I will discuss this again in my UR process, so I will discuss these things in detail. Now when our capillary forces are high due to high IFT and lower porosity and permeability, residual oil saturation are on the higher side. Modified water flooding using surfactant can overcome these forces and improve the recovery factor. By increasing the injection rate of the displacing fluid, my recovery can be improved to some extent. Coming to viscous forces, the viscous forces are due to the internal friction among the molecules of moving fluid and external friction with solid with other faces. It is defined as the pressure gradient, that is the pressure drop per unit length, which is proportional to the viscosity and velocity of the moving fluid. Alright, so this is viscous forces. Again, my main aim over here is to increase my capillary number. Whatever mechanism will increase my capillary number, I will try to implement it so that I will get a low residual oil saturation in the reservoir. Okay. Again, I will discuss these things when I discuss EOR in pretty much detail. As of now, let's move further. Now, as we all know, my reservoir is a bundle of capillary. Okay. Now you can see that in this particular figure, you can see that whenever I am having small pores, at that time my capillary forces would be very high. Okay, now over here in this case I am having smaller pores. Now in this particular region you can see that my capillary forces are less. Okay, and in this particular region where my pore sizes are very large, my capillary forces are very low. Okay, so as we know, my reservoir is a bundle of capillaries. Reservoir implies bundle of capillaries. Okay. So what I want to say over is that if I'm having small pore sizes, that means my capillary forces would be very high. All right. As compared to when I'm having high or large pore sizes. Okay. Now let's discuss capillary pressure. As we all know, capillary pressure is the difference in pressure across an interface, across two immiscible phases in a capillary tube. Capillary pressure equal to the difference in the pressure of non-wetting phase minus my pressure of wetting phase. It can be represented as sigma, or the interfacial tension between 1 and 2 into 1 upon R1 plus 1 upon R2. Okay, that will be equal to my difference in pressure across my non-wetting phase minus my pressure at wetting phase. Okay, over here the R1 means the this particular region is my R1, whatever radius I am getting over here is R1, and this would be R2. Okay, alright. Now let's look at the theory part. The rise or the depression of the fluids in the fine bore tubes इज अ रिजल्ट ऑफ द सर्फेस टेंशन एंड वेटिंग प्रेफरेंस एंड इज कॉल्ड कैपिलैरिटी. कैपिलरी प्रेशर एग्जिस्ट व्हेन टू इमिसिबल फेसेस आर प्रेजेंट, फॉर एग्जाम्पल इन अ बोर ट्यूब, एंड इज डिफाइंड एज द प्रेशर ड्रॉप अक्रॉस द कर्व्ड लिक्विड इंटरफेस. अगेन एज आई मेंशन इज दैट द प्रेशर डिफरेंस दैट आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट ओवर हियर, द वॉट एवर प्रेशर डिफरेंस दैट आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट, इट्स द प्रेशर डिफरेंस अक्रॉस द कर्व्ड लिक्विड सर्फेस. ओके, दैट मीन्स ओवर हियर, लेट्स टेक एन एग्जाम्पल ओवर हियर. The pressure drop. Oh, this is my wetting phase. Let this be my wetting phase and let this be my non-wetting phase. Okay. So whatever pressure drop I am obtaining at this interface between the non-wetting and wetting phase, the difference in the pressure gives us the capillary pressure. All right. Look at this particular figure. This is my drainage and imbibition capillary pressure curves. So this curve is between capillary pressure versus my saturation of water. Okay. Now. Let's look at the drainage over here. So this particular green trend indicates my drainage, and this red trend indicates my imbibition part. Coming to drainage, when my fluid flow process in which the saturation of the non-wetting phase increases, drainage means my fluid flow processes where my saturation of the non-wetting phase increases. The mobility of the non-wetting phase increases as the non-wetting phase saturation increases. So you can see that drainage over here. This is a water wet case. Let's assume that this is a water wet region. Okay. Now you can see that since this graph is between my capillary pressure versus saturation, you can see that my water saturation is reducing in this direction. So that means my non-wetting phase saturation is increasing and my wetting phase saturation is decreasing. Hence, it is termed as drainage. Okay. And this drainage, examples of drainage are when my hydrocarbon or the oil or gas fills the pore space and displacing the original water or deposition in the water bed rock. This is the first case. Second case is when my water, I am going for a water flooding and oil reservoir in which the reservoir is oil wet. That can also be a water, that can also be a drainage case. So I am having gas. Gas will always be a non-wetting phase. Okay. So whenever I am going for a gas injection in an oil bed or a water bed rock, at that time I can experience drainage process. Fourth is whenever I'm going for a pressure maintenance or a gas cycling by gas injection in a retrograde condensation reservoir. Fifth point is evaluation of a secondary gas cap as my reservoir pressure decreases. Okay, so these are the examples of my drainage case where my non-wetting phase saturation is increasing and my wetting phase saturation is going down. Now coming to imbibition case where my fluid flow process in which the saturation of the wetting phase increases. Okay, so this is my imbibition phase. So mobility of the wetting phase increases as my wetting phase saturation increases. Okay, so in this particular figure, this red trend indicates my imbibition process. So you can see that my saturation is increasing in this direction. That is my water bed. Since this example is for a water bed rock, my water saturation is increasing in the right direction, and my trend is also going in this direction. So it is an imbibition case. All right. Okay. Now let's look at the example where we have a imbibition process. Now, accumulation of oil in an oil bed reservoir is an imbibition process. Water flooding an oil reservoir in which reservoir is water bed. This is a process of imbibition. Third case is when accumulation of condensate as pressure decreases in the dew point reservoir. Okay, so these are the three examples of imbibition. All right, I will discuss this imbibition and drain. As of now, I am just explaining you the basic part. Look at the points on the curve over here. So this is my irreducible water phase wetting phase saturation. Okay, this SM point will be my 1 minus residual non-wetting phase saturation. Okay, if this was a water bed rock, then this would have been my initial or a coronet water saturation, or this, and this would have been my residual oil saturation. PD over here is my displacement pressure. I will discuss PD in coming up slide, where the displacement pressure is the pressure required to force the non-wetting fluid into the largest pores. Okay, so this would be my displacement pressure, and lambda is my pore size distribution index that I will discuss in coming up slide, and it will be based on the shape of the pores. Okay, now let's move further. Now let's look at this figure. This is a very important figure. Okay, now this figure shows us the curve between saturation and PC. Okay, over here it is for depth also. Okay, depth and capillary pressure versus my water saturation. So this point is my free water level. This point is my oil water contact. The pressure over here is my displacement pressure.
at this point my capillary pressure will be equal to zero, and this point, okay, that means this is my irreducible water saturation, okay, and the height, this is my transition, top of the transition zone, okay, and this over here my clean oil will be obtained. Now coming to this free water level, free water level will be obtained when my when I am having a 100% water saturation, okay, when I am having 100% water saturation and when I am having a capillary pressure equal to zero, at that point my free water level will start, okay, and the free water level will be till the point where I am having my saturation of water is equal to 100, okay. That means this height, that means from PC is equal to zero to PC is equal to PD, PD is my displacement pressure, okay, or entry pressure, and the height till where I am getting my saturation of water equal to 100, I will get my free water level, okay. Now coming to this point, that is oil water contact. Oil water contact means the point where I am having my PC is equal to PD, okay, that means PC is equal to PD, PD over A is my displacement pressure, okay, or the minimum entry pressure. So PC is equal to PD and the point where I am getting saturation of water equal to 100, so that point can be termed as my oil water contact, okay. Transition zone will lie between my saturation of 100% water to the irreducible water saturation, okay. So whatever height that is occupied between these two zones, that is 100% water saturation to the irreducible water saturation, so this height will constitute my transition zone. This region will be indicated by my clean oil. There is a region of immobile oil also that we should discuss over here. So this is my region of immobile oil, okay, that means I will have high amount of residual oil, that means this saturation over here, this particular saturation is my residual oil saturation. Particular region I obtained when I'm having a, this is my drainage curve, okay, drainage curve, and this is my imbibition curve, okay. So this particular range or this particular region over here, I can identify it to be my immobile oil region. All right, okay. Now to find out my, if I want to find out my height in my capillary tube, so that will be equal to my H is equal to PC upon delta rho g, where PC is equal to H rho g, okay. Now to find out the height in feet, I have to place 144 PC upon del rho, okay. So if I keep my PC in my PSI and if I keep my density in pound per feet cube, so I can get my answer in height equal to feet unit. Now if I want to find out my height in meter unit, I will place my, this will be in a formula where 0.102 PC upon del rho, where PC is in Newton per meter square and my density will be in kg per meter cube. Now if I am told to find out what would be, at what height I will get my oil water contact, so the height would be 144 PD upon del rho, okay. So this height over here, this is the height over here, that means that is the height between my free water level and my oil water contact, that will give, to find out that I have this formula which is 144 PD upon del rho. Now to find out what is the depth of my oil water contact, for that I will place my depth of free water level minus 144 PD upon del rho. Let's look at the effect of gravity on capillary curves. Now you can see that if I am having a high density oil, if I am having a high density oil or a low gravity oil, okay, low gravity means my API, as we know, my API is equal to 141.5 specific gravity minus 131.5, okay, that means high API phi, that means my density is low. If my API is low, implies my density is high, okay. So if I am having a low gravity oil or high density oil, I will get this kind of a trend, capillary pressure of this kind of trend, okay. Now if I am having a low gravity, if I am having a low density oil or a high gravity oil, so this will be my capillary pressure trend. So this would be the trend for my increasing density of oil. Now effect of permeability, effect of reservoir permeability, if I am talking about this, then low permeability reservoir, this would be my trend, and for high permeability reservoir, this will be my trend. All right, okay. let's discuss pore throat sorting or PTS. Basically, it provides a measure of pore geometry and the sorting of pore throats within a rock sample. So PTS is third under root of third quartile pressure to first quartile pressure. That means first and the third quartile pressure represent the capillary pressures at 25 and 75% saturation of water respectively. Thus, a value of PTS close to 1 indicates that the porous medium is well sorted. That is, the capillary pressures do not change significantly, or a plateau region is obtained. So you can see that in this particular figure, this red region indicates a highly sorted case or a plateau region. However, a value of PTS much greater than 1 indicates that the sample is poorly sorted, evidenced by the rapid jump in the capillary pressure curve after crossing the 25% saturation. So you can see that in this particular figure, my red region shows us the highly sorted reservoir or a plateau region is obtained. That means my PTS is almost equal to 1 or a close to 1. When I am having high PTS or when I am having a high pore throat sorting, at that time I can say that I will be having a poorly sorted system, and you can see a definite jump in the capillary pressure curve. See, you can see that I am not obtaining any sort of plateau. So this particular figure shows us a cuboidal reservoir where I am having water and oil. Okay, so from we already discussed before also. So this would be my oil region, this would be my transition region, this would be my free water level. Okay, so corresponding to this, I will get a capillary pressure versus saturation curve. Okay, and corresponding this, I will get a rel pump curve, where this will be my coronet water saturation and this is my irreducible oil saturation. Alright, okay. Now, in this particular figure, you can see that, okay, for a particular capillary tube, okay, I have a capillary tube which is present, which is dipped in this system. Okay, this is my oil region, this is my water region, and this water is my wetting phase and this is my non-wetting phase. So you can see that because of this capillarity, I am generating some sort of a pressure across this immiscible phase. Okay, and because of this immiscible phase, I am getting this height of the fluid which is rising up. Alright, so in this particular case, this would be my oil zone, this would be my water zone, and whatever height this capillary has gone up, this would be my transition zone. Alright, okay. Over this particular figure, I have two different cases of a water wet rock and non-wet oil and the oil wet rock. So in a capillary tube, water wetting surface forces cause the water to rise. Okay, over here, this is a water wetting phase, and because of this capillarity over here, my water wetting phase, that is my water is rising in my tube. Okay, displacing the oil, whatever oil is there, it is displacing it. But if the tube inner phase is oil wetting, the oil will push water down. Okay, in this right thing, in the right figure, you can see that since this is my this capillarity is an oil wet system, what it is trying to do is that my oil is trying to push my water down. It would be the corresponding capillary pressure versus saturation curve. From that, I can also get my depth also. Alright, okay. So this particular figure shows us how different kind of a wetting phase affects our capillarity. Alright, now let's move further. So this particular figure over here, this particular curve gives us the holistic review of my capillary pressure curves. So again, capillary pressure versus saturation is given, and four different reservoir systems are compared over here. That is, for system A, system B, system C, system D, I have individual capillary pressure curves. Okay, now let's discuss each and every system in detail. When I'm having a curve A system, that means the rock A has the least displacement pressure. You can see that over here, my capillary pressure, that means the displacement pressure at for this curve A is the least. What does this indicate? Let's look. This indicates that it has the largest pores connected to the surface. Its capillary pressure curve remains essentially flat as the wetting phase saturation is decreased from 100% to 60%. This means that many of the pores are invaded by the non-wetting fluid at essentially the same capillarity pressure. This indicates that A has uniform pores or is well sorted. You can see that I can see a definite plateau period over here. I am reducing my water saturation from 100% to around 60%. I am getting a similar capillary pressure, which indicates I am having a uniform pores or I am having a large pores. Okay, the rock A has least irreducible wetting phase saturation, indicating that it has relatively larger grains and the pores than the other rocks. Okay, you can also see that my irreducible water saturation that I am obtaining from the capillary curve A, it is also less, which indicates that my pore spaces are large in curve A. Okay, that means curve A indicates that my pore spaces are larger. Second, I am also having uniform pore throats. Okay, because I am getting a platypillar. Now coming to curve B, rock B has a higher displacement pressure than curve A. You can see that for curve B, I am having a higher displacement pressure. Therefore, it has smaller pores as compared to A. The capillary pressure curve at the high wetting phase saturation is relatively flat, indicating good sorting. Over here also, I can see a platypillar, which indicates that it has some sort of a uniform sorting. My rock B has higher irreducible wetting phase saturation than A, which is consistent with its finer grains and pores. Okay. For my curve B, I am getting a irreducible water saturation which is higher as compared to curve A. That means comparatively my pore spaces are small in rock B. Coming to curve C, my rock C is even more fine grained than B because of higher displacement pressure, that you can see in curve C also. In curve C, I am having a higher displacement pressure. The shape of the capillarity curve shows that a high capillarity pressure is required at each wetting phase saturation to desaturate the rock. This means the curve has higher, wider pore space distribution than A and B. See, I am hardly getting any sort of a platypillar over here. That means my throating is, or my sorting is very poor. Okay, it is poorly sorted. And it has high irreducible water saturation than B, which is consistent that it has finer grains. See, my irreducible water saturation is also very high. That means my rock C has high fine grains. Okay, finer grains is present and my pore spaces are very less. Coming to curve D, curve D is extremely fine grained, extremely poor sorted, and would be a poor reservoir rock. This would be a very poor reservoir rock because, see, look at the displacement pressure, and there is hardly any sorting present. Okay, plus look at the irreducible saturation also. Okay, it is very high. That means it has very fine grains. The observation is based on its very high displacement pressure, very steep capillary pressure curve, and high irreducible wetting phase saturation. Alright, okay. So over here in this particular, this is a very beautiful figure which represents how a reservoir rock varies. For cases, if I want to identify which is the best reservoir rock, then I will definitely choose rock A. Rock A is my best reservoir rock and rock D is my worst reservoir rock. Alright, okay, now let's move further.
Let's discuss factors affecting water flood performance. Reservoir and fluid characteristics. Average depth. It is not a critical parameter but can be a operational restraint. That means depth, let's say if my depth of the well is high, okay, for that my pump ratings would also be high. Okay, let's say I have a higher depth reservoir where I am going for water flooding. Okay, that means it will require high amount of water injection pressure. Okay, and now if I want high amount of water injection pressure, I will have the requirement of high rating pumps. So that's a operational restraint that I can pose, I can so-called have when I have a high depth water injector. Now, second thing is, now if I'm having a high depth water injector and if I'm going for higher water injection pressure, this means that my surface lines should be capable enough to hold that high pressure. Okay, so high rating flanges, walls, and also the condition of the pipelines should be intact before you go for water injection at higher depths. Coming to structure, dip. Gravity plays predominant role in an anticlinal bed. High dip or high permeable reservoir leads to a good recovery. Horizontal beds can have a early breakthrough. You can see that this is a dipping reservoir and this is a horizontal bed. Horizontal beds can have a early breakthrough and this dipping kind of a reservoir leads to better recovery. I will discuss these things in detail in coming up sessions. Okay. As of now, let's move ahead. Homogeneity. Homogeneous reservoir give better recovery and control multiple breakthroughs. That means if I am having a homogeneous reservoir, then we can expect a proper front. Flood front can be proper. Whereas if I am having a heterogeneous reservoir,
then I can experience multiple breakthroughs, which is undesirable, and multiple breakthrough can lead to lesser recovery factor. Coming to petrophysical parameters, high porosity leads to high recovery, obvious. High permeability is also encouraging. High capillary forces may prove to be detrimental. Okay, high capillary forces means I have low permeability reservoir. That means my pore spaces available will be very small. So high capillary forces may prove detrimental. Coming to fluid characteristics, viscosity of oil directly affects the recovery. Higher the viscosity of oil, less would be the recovery. Lesser the viscosity of oil, better would be the recovery. Recovery increases with decrease in oil viscosity, obvious. Now you can see that if someone is asking me a question, when to go for a, which is the ideal time to go for a waterflood project, then I would term that when my reservoir pressure is at bubble point pressure, I will go for a waterflood project. The reason is, at my bubble point pressure, you can see the viscosity of the oil is the least. That's why, as again we know, the recovery increases with decrease in oil viscosity. And since at my bubble point, since my oil viscosity is the least, I will go for a waterflood project at that particular time. That means when my pressure, reservoir pressure is equal to bubble point pressure, I will go for a waterflood project. Let's move further. Deciding time for water flood. Let's discuss technical aspects. Coming to technical aspects, reservoir oil viscosity. Oil has lower viscosity at saturation pressure. As mentioned before, at my bubble point pressure, I will go for water flooding. Gas saturation. If I'm going for a water injection, then less than 10% of free gas saturation before water injection is good. If I'm going for a gas injection, then free gas saturation is not desirable. Coming to reservoir pressure, higher is the reservoir, higher the pressure before the water injection, better it is. Okay, if I am having higher reservoir pressure, then it would be better for water, going for a water injection. It gives larger drawdown and longer life to well, which is favorable for good economics for the water flooding project. Now coming to economical aspects, cost of injection equipments, hardware, software, maintenance, services, etc. Okay, so this included in economical aspects. Overall life of a reservoir, operating expenses are essential parts of a water flooding project. It should be commenced as early as possible. Financial consideration, NPVs, IRRs and economic analysis of the project should be proper. Okay. Coming to the displacement efficiency as a function of water saturation, I can write my ED or my displacement efficiency as volume of oil at the start of the flood minus the remaining oil volume divided by oil of volume at the start of the flood. Obvious. Okay, this is how you find, this is the formula to find out my displacement efficiency. Now this can be written as ED equal to SOI upon BOI minus SO upon BO upon SOI minus BOI. As we know, my BOI will be equal to BO for a water injection process, because I am assuming my reservoir pressure to be almost constant throughout when I am going for a water injection. Okay, so my ED can be written as SOI minus SO divided by SOI, where SOI is my initial oil saturation and my SO is my residual oil saturation. From this I can get my displacement efficiency. Now this SOI can be written as 1 minus SWI, obvious, minus SGI if I am having some sort of initial gas saturation, minus my residual oil saturation upon minus my residual saturation upon my SOI. Okay, this can be written as SW minus SWI upon 1 minus SWI, where SWI is my initial water saturation, SW is my water saturation at the beginning of project, at the rate water flood project. Okay, if this condition is applicable when my SGI is 0 or my initial gas saturation is 0, at that time this particular case is applicable. Okay, now ED can be written as 1 minus SWI minus SGI upon minus 1 minus SWI upon SOI. Well, these are the formulas that you can use when someone is asking you to find out what will be the displacement efficiency. Okay, now let's look at this particular thing. ED will increase as average water saturation in the swept area keeps on increasing, which is obvious. But how can we calculate average water saturation at different times or as a function of injected water? For this, Buckley-Leverett in 1942 gave us frontal advancement theory. In my next session, I will be discussing this frontal advancement theory. Okay, so as of now, let's move further. Now, I have a small numerical over here. I need to calculate the displacement efficiency from the given well pump. As we know, this is my Cornet water saturation. This is my residual oil saturation. Cornet water is 0.2, residual oil is 0.85. Now, from the graph, I got SWC Cornet water as 0.2, which leads to my initial oil saturation to be 0.8. 1 minus SW will give me 0.8. SOR, or residual oil saturation at the end of the project, is 0.15. Okay, now to find out my ED or displacement efficiency, I will keep my SOI minus SOR upon SOI, which will be equal to 1 minus SWC minus SOR upon 1 minus SWC. Alright, now on placing the values, I will get my displacement efficiency as 81.25%. Alright, okay, let's move further. Coming to injection well location, again a very important concept. Peripheral flooding, okay, peripheral flooding means on the periphery of my field. See, these all are my producer wells, okay, these all are my producer wells, and on the periphery of these producer wells I have my injector wells. All right see, my this circle is indicated by producing well, and this triangular thing is indicates my injection well. Now let's look at the theory. In peripheral flooding, the injection wells are located at the external boundary. The peripheral flood generally yields a maximum oil recovery with a minimum of produced water. The production of significant quantities of water can be delayed until only the last row of producers remains. Obvious. Because of the unusually small number of injectors compared with the number of producers, it takes a long time for the injected water to fill up the reservoir gas space. This result is a delay in the field response to the flood. For a successful peripheral flood, the formation permeability must be large enough to permit the movement of injected water at the desired rate over the distance of several well spacing from the injection wells to the last line of producers. Entire portion of where I am having my injector wells, I should have a proper high permeable reservoirs, okay? Then only the effect of my peripheral flooding will be maximum. If my permeability is not that high, then there is less effect of my peripheral flooding. To keep the injection well so close as possible to the water flood front without bypassing any movable oil, water dot producers may be converted into injectors. However, moving the location of the injection wells frequently requires laying longer surface water lines and adding costs. Converting a producer well into an injector well, this will help us in reducing the amount of bypassed oil. Okay. Now, if I am reducing the amount of bypassed oil, this means I am getting a better recovery. Alright, results from the peripheral flooding are more difficult to predict. The displacing fluid tends to displace the oil bank past the inside producers, which are thus difficult to produce. Coming to the injection rates are generally a problem because the injection wells continue to push the water at greater distances. Alright, let's move further. Coming to pattern flooding. It is principally employed in reservoirs having a small dip and large surface area. For a small dip and large surface area. Alright. In order to ensure a uniform sweep, the injection wells are distributed amongst the production wells. This is done either by converting existing production wells into injectors or by drilling infill injection wells. Over there, when we were discussing peripheral, at that time we were seeing that I was keeping my wells at this outer boundary. Okay. But in pattern flooding, we are keeping my injector wells between my producer wells. Okay, so there are different patterns that we will be following. Okay, I can go for a direct line drive, staggered line, 4-spot, 5-spot, 7-spot, 9-spot. Look at this particular figure. This particular figure is for a direct line drive. So you can see that my producer wells are kept. These circle ones indicate producer wells, and these wells with the arrow shows my injector wells. Okay, so in a direct line only, I have kept my producer as well as injector wells. Coming to staggered line. Staggered line, you can see that my producer wells are kept in between. See, my producer wells are kept in between. Okay, not exactly in line with the injector wells. Okay, in between the injector wells, my producer wells are kept, and not in line with the injector wells. Okay, so this kind of a pattern is a staggered line drive. Coming to 5-spot pattern, you can see that my injector wells. Okay. 5-spot pattern means in a square type pattern, I have a producer well in between. okay, I can have a regular as well as an inverted pattern. Okay, regular pattern means, let's say regular pattern means one producer well will be inside and injector wells will be in the outside direction. Okay, inverted pattern means I will be having producer wells in the outside and one injector well in the inside part. Okay, so inverted means injector well in the inside part, and regular pattern means injector wells are in the outside part and my producer well is in the middle. Okay, now coming to seventh spot, you can see that some hexagonal kind of a structure is made and in between there will be a producer well when I'm talking about a regular pattern. When I'm talking about inverted seventh spot, I will have a producer well on the periphery of my hexagonal and inside it I will have one injector well. Coming to fourth spot, again there will be a triangular structure. Okay, so if I'm talking about an inverted fourth spot, then I will have producer well in the outside of a triangle and injector well in the inside. And I'm talking about a regular fourth spot, I will have injector wells on the periphery and I will have one producer well in between. Coming to ninth spot regular pattern, I will have injector wells outside this pattern. See, I am having 8 wells in the outside rectangular pattern. Okay, and in between I will have one producer well when I'm talking about a regular ninth spot. When I'm talking about inverted ninth spot, I will have 8 producers and one injector well inside. Okay, that's why it is inverted. Now I will prove this P by I ratio. Okay, in coming up slide I will prove this. Now P, where P indicates my number of production wells, I indicates number of injection wells, D equal to distance from an injector to the line connecting two producing wells, A is the distance between wells in line in regular pattern. Now EA equal to my aerial sweep. Now if I am comparing the aerial sweep efficiency based on the patterns, then for a direct line I will have 56%, for staggered I will have 78%, for a 5 spot I will be getting 72% of recovery, and my 7 spot will have around 80% of recovery. Okay, let's move further. Now you can see that for a direct line, this is for a direct line. Over here the triangle indicates my injection well and circle indicates my production well. For a direct line I will get my P by I or I by P equal to 1. Okay, because one, for every one injector well there is a producer well. Okay, now coming to staggered line, again this triangle indicates injection well, the circle indicates production well. My P by I or the I by P ratio will be 1, because for every one injector well there is one producer well. Coming to 5 spot pattern, okay, over here I'm talking about a regular 5 spot pattern. Okay, now for regular 5 spot pattern, you can see that, okay, in this diagram also you can see I have an injector well on the outside of the square, okay, and one producer well in the inside part. Alright, so now injector well, I have, now as we can see that if I'm having one injector well in the outside part, so it will only contribute to me my 1/4% of the flow. Let's see if I'm considering a circle over here. Okay, that means my contribution of this particular well will be 90/360, that is 1/4. Okay, similarly this injector well will also contribute 1/4, this will also contribute 1/4. Okay, this will also contribute 1/4. As a result, my injector contribution will be 1/4 or 90/360 into the, since there are 4 number of injectors, I will multiply 4, that will give me 1. Okay, now again I have one producer well in the center, so that's why I will be having one producer well over here. So my I by P or the P by I ratio will be equal to 1. Alright, okay, let's move further. Coming to this 4 spot pattern, okay, let me discuss a 4 spot regular pattern over here. Again, 4 spot regular pattern means I am having one producer well in the center and 3 injector wells in the outside. Alright, now again using the same logic, if I am having one injector well over here, okay, that means if I am considering a circle, okay, that means it will only contribute to me, if I am talking about the contribution of this particular well, then it would be 60/360. Okay, that means it will be only 1/6. Got it? Okay, so again this one injector well will give me 1/6, this injector will again give me 1/6, and this will also give me 1/6. Okay, since I am having 3 injector wells, so it will be 3/60/360, that will give me 1/2. Alright, again since there is one producer well, and if I am told to find out what will be my P by I ratio, So P by I ratio will be 1 upon 1 by 2. That means my P by A ratio will be 2 for a regular 4 spot. Alright, to normal 7 spot pattern. So let's look at that particular case. Now, for a normal 7 spot, again I have a injector wells on the outside direction and one producer well in the inside. Okay, why 7 spot? Because over here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 injector plus 1 producer. That's why it is called 7 spot. Okay, now let's look at this particular injector well. This particular injector well, if I am taking at how much amount of contribution will come from this particular injector well, okay, then I can say this, that 120 upon 360 is being contributed by this particular well. Okay, if I am considering the angle over it, then this is 120. As we know, for a hexagon, I will be having 120, 120 at each and every angle. Okay, so 120 upon 360, that is 1 by 3. Okay, that means 1 by 3 is contributed by this well. Okay, one well. So this will also give me 1 by 3. This particular injector will also give me 1 by 3. In this way, all the injector well will give me 1 by 3 portion of the contribution. So since I am having 6 injector well into 1 by 3, so my answer would be 2. Got it? So injector contribution is 2 and producer contribution is 1 because only one injector well is present in the inside part. So for my normal spot, normal 7 spot, my P by I would be equal to 2. Got it? Over here, normal 9 spot is given. Okay. Now, in this, for this wells at the corner, for the wells present at the corners, okay, we will find it differently, and wells at the center of the side, we will calculate it differently. Okay, now for the wells at the corner, see over here 1 by 4th part is contributing. Okay, that means 90 by 360, which is 1 by 4th is contributing. Okay, for all these 4 wells which are present at the corner. Alright, so 1 by 4th into 4 plus. Now coming to these wells which are present at the edges, okay, which are present at the sides, okay, that means, see, if I'm considering this well, then 1 by 2, okay, half portion is given. That means my 1 by 80 angle is contributing. That means 1 by 80 upon 360, which is 1 by 2. Okay, that is 1 by 2 into, since there are 4 wells present at the sides, so 1 by 2 into 4. Okay, so my answer would be 1 plus 2 equal to 3. Okay, so my injector wells would be 3 over here, and my producer well, again, since only one well is present at the center, my producer will be 1. Alright, okay, now let's move further. Now talking about crestal and basal injection patterns. In crestal injection patterns, as the name implies, the injection is through the wells located at the top of the structure. Gas injection projects typically use a crestal gas injection pattern. In basal injection, the fluid is injected at the bottom of the structure. Many water injection projects use basal patterns, with additional benefits being gained from gravity segregation. Alright, so over here, if I am going for a water injection well, I will be going for a basal pattern, and if I am going for a gas injection well, I will go for a crestal pattern. Alright, okay, because we are using the help of my gravity segregation for injections. Alright. Okay, so that's all for today. Thank you and Jai Hind.